have a slideshow, and it will show my gardens, and it'll have the names of a lot of different conifers on the slide itself. And they're self-explanatory, and I might make some comments, but we'll go through the slides rather quickly so that and jot down any questions that you have. Now, as a member of American Conifer Society, we get booklets, and I'm cleaning house, so I'd like you to take one or two and keep them, and, or take a couple and give them to friends if anybody's interested. That's the quarterly, and then it's a national organization, and if you're really interested in conifers, it's extremely helpful. And they also have a Middle Western called Conifer for our local area. And like any plant organization, they have meetings and all that kind of thing. Okay. Any questions before we begin? Okay, we'll start with the slideshow, and I think they'll turn on even more lights here. So. Okay, this is just a little stone entrance to my garden. It's flat on the ground. And this was in 2004. That was the year I basically started the conifer gardens, and that's what I had, just that circle garden with the flag in it that had a walk around, probably 30 feet in diameter. And Ronald Reagan died that June. That's why the flag is attached to that. And I retired from my work as a librarian that same year too, and so I wanted to get into gardening big time, and I picked conifers. And I actually went online and found where I could find garden designs. Easy to do, you know, and you can move the plants around and create the design that you wish. And I only did this for the Lion Garden, my one specialty garden, but it was kind of fun. And you notice you can see the path. You see up at the top, that's a big lion fountain that we put in, and it was just kind of a fun project. This is the start of our lion garden, and I would judge it's 30 feet by 15, 20 feet deep, and we started out with a lion bench was the beginning of the theme for it. There's two lion faces on that bench, and I've had that for years and years. And then we just started using the plant. And this was its second year after it was planted. And you can see later on, I'll show you one after it's fully developed. But you can see that I allowed enough room, but not so much that it looks so sparse. You're caught between having it look sparse for years and then having it overgrowing. And I just decided I wanted it to look nice right away. This is a burn garden. I have a lot of different garden areas in like a 3-acre section. The burn garden is behind the bricks there, and it rises up probably 4.5 feet high on the far side. And that gives you a lot of dimension in your garden, depth and dimension. Then I have a circle rock garden, and this is one of our favorites. This circle area was an area of old-fashioned lilacs. And it was a big circle, and it kept getting wider and wider and wider. I didn't like it. But, then we had a bobcat guy doing something else, and I said, get rid of those, and he did. And then, of course, there's this big circle of bare dirt, so what does gardener do? We went to my home farm, which is about 3 miles away, and gathered rocks from the rock pile and did a circle rock garden. And filled it with conifers. And we have what we call a pool garden, and it's just a little area. This was where that original garden that I had with the flag, that I have a little pool behind this weed Norway blue spruce. That was our first big purchase. And this is a little pool behind it. It's just small, but it does support a water lily. It's deep enough for that. And then I have a woods garden, which I call the arborvita on the left, and a blue spruce on the right. And when designing gardens, it's always good to have something to beckon you in. So if you have an arch, have something, or a gate to go through, have something that makes you want to go further. And I have an angel statue in there. And that's just a little woods, and that's the only thing I do in there other than mow a path. Sometimes this is sticky. Okay, then the big project that Larry and I had was we had these old cloth gazebos in this area for years. We went through two or three of them and then blew them down in the snow wet and they were a mess. So I said, let's do a permanent one. So we put bricks in, and I think we could have built the house on top of it. We put so much effort into it. It was a lot of work. Gazebo that we put in, and it's a really wonderful structure. It snow slides off of it, and it's just been wonderful. And that's about 15 years old now, I think. And this is Larry, and he is the reason that I have these extensive gardens, and he is a photographer. So he took a lot of the slides. He said, I put this picture in so I could show him. He said, if you show them that picture, they'll think all I have is this little teeny camera. He's kind of vain. So I said, okay, so here's this big camera. And this is the lion garden as it's maturing. And you see the lion fountain in the back. I have many fountains in my yard because Larry was nuts about them. And he manhandled them and set them up. But this one was really an unusual find because it was on sale for half price. Now, that topiary tree is a Korean lilac, and we had to move that because I found that didn't get enough sun on that one side, so it was just getting really lopsided growth. So it needs full sun on all sides, so that no longer is in there. And here's just a lion, and then I collect sun faces. And this is a blue star juniper, that little silver plant by the front of the gate. And that's just a stunning thing because it is that sparkly silver blue all the time. They're readily available. I had about six of them, and I'm down to four now. They don't all survive. This one likes that spot where it's in. And they like to be covered with snow, too. And this is the front entrance. There's a blue spruce on a standard on the left of the angel statuary. When it's on a standard, that means it has a long trunk. And usually, frequently, they're grafted on top of this long trunk. The trunk is what the standard is. And this is another view of a lion in the lion garden. We've got, I think, 10 of them in there. And they're kind of hidden, so they're not overwhelming. And if little kids come over, I always ask them to count them and see how many are in there. This bright chartreuse green conifer is a mother lode juniper. And it's one of my favorites. It's that bright golden color all year long. It grows very, very slowly, and winters over really well. It likes to be covered with snow. And you can see the contrast. There's the Colorado blues and the that motherlode juniper, and then there's a Norway bird's nest spruce in the front, and the color contrast is remarkable. Okay, this is a view of the berm garden through the arch. Like I said, you want to have arches have something to look at through them. Okay, this is a dwarf Alberta spruce, and they're beautiful, and you're probably all familiar with them. They're bright green, and they look so gorgeous in the nurseries, but nobody should plant them in this area because they have winter burn, just always. You can't avoid it. I have tried covering them with burlap, and that worked for a few years, but then I've just given up on them. They're frequently sold decorated as Christmas trees, even, and then you can plant the tree, but it's a bad deal. Okay, this is that winter burn on that conifer, and there's no recovery from that. You just have to get rid of it. And that happens when, in late January and February, when the angle of the sun is so hot and the snow is so white, and it just gets that intense reflection, and it just burns the needles. And this is, I don't know, have all of these memorized, but the Anglo-Saxon names for conifers, it's kind of, those are the common ones that we can grow here. This is a way to protect evergreens in the winter, and it's just for fence posts and burlap. And I ordered, when we were into it big time and a lot of the conifers were little babies, I ordered a bolt of burlap off the internet at a really good price, so then we could just cut it up and, you know, cover the trees that we wanted to. This is an old lace juniper, blue shag white pine. I've got samples of this in the back. This is an interesting one because if you brush your hands through it, it's just like you're brushing through feathers. It's all soft and beautiful. And I have two of them. It's one of our favorite, but it's also a favorite of the deer. They just like to eat it when they rub their antlers on it. This is large Diana. Larix is a large, and this is a unique specimen because it's weeping and it's also contorted. And it just produces interesting shapes. It's about 30 feet tall now, and it was about 4 feet when I bought it.
They grow pretty fast.
It grows pretty fast, probably a foot a year at least. But it's beautiful because it doesn't create a lot of shade. And it's just been good. And then they turn beautiful in the fall, as you know. Sometimes this doesn't do the right time. This is a gold blue spruce, and this was in the Lion Garden, and this was the first year that I planted them, and they were about this big a piece, and I planted them about 3 feet apart. And if you notice the repetition, I have three of them, and then I have three little princess spirea in front of them, too. And if you're planting a garden, repetition is an important concept. If you put one of each thing all around, it looks kind of haphazard. But with conifers, you can have one specimen one easily in your perennial gardens as well. But, this is my favorite, silver log Korean fir, and I have a sample of that in the back. It has silvery needles. They're white and silver all year long, and it has absolutely beautiful cones. No, that isn't probably not yet. There's a cone. And it looks like little butterflies had landed all around that cone, and it's about 4 inches high. And it had a lot of them. And this is a monoecious tree, meaning it has both male and female cones on the same tree. A lot of conifers have that. And this is the female cone. And the male cones are little tiny things. This is just another view, but look at how beautiful those needles are. And if you look at the bulletin board that I brought, you can see them. Juniper, and junipers have little berries, which are their cones. So not all conifers have cones. These junipers have berries, and they're beautiful. They look like little blueberries, and they're out right now on the tree. It's a gorgeous thing with the red bark. The gold mop cypress, and they're just beautiful fluffy mounds of gorgeous golden chartreuse color. This is a chalet Swiss stone pine. And I have to say, this is a deceased tree. We had it for over 12 years, and it didn't make it last winter. Last winter was hard on conifers, particularly the other things. But it's just a beautiful tree, and I would easily get another one. Peabody arborvita, and this is not a miniature one. It's about this tall right now, and it maintains that golden, beautiful color throughout the year. This is a weeping Norway spruce, that tall, scraggly looking thing in the back that's weeping over. Okay, this is a Seister Colorado blue spruce. And this is just to show you how beautiful they are in the winter. It's a far cry from a purely perennial flower bed that hasn't got much going for it in the winter. And you can see that this also is on a standard, and it just means they're off the ground, and they can be a foot or 5 feet tall. This is a weeping white spruce. This one we've had for 15 years too. It's one of our favorites. This is in the spring, and the bright green tips is the new growth, and they're called candles. And if you want to prune spruce, you can cut those candles in half. You can pinch them off with your fingers if it's a little specimen, but then it will keep growing and not damage it. This is Dobbs frosted juniper, and they've developed all the plants that can grow upright now. There's upright Moogle pines as well as the little brown ones that we know. And this is the same Dobbs frosted juniper around that statue. And that statue is only this tall, and we thought that didn't look good any place in the yard where we put it, so we built a circle of stones and lined it with landscape fabric and filled it with dirt. Put her in there and planted some conifers around it. And you can see the four different conifers in that picture too, in contrasting colors and shapes. Okay, this is a weeping European larch, and it's just a dandy. It has done well. Just cascades, it's probably this tall as I am, and again, loses its needles in the fall in the beautiful yellow color. This is a cone on it, really big, large. It looks just like a little earring on the tree to me. Here's a bird's nest spruce, and that's just a dwarf form of a Norway spruce. Here's Mop's dwarf bugle pine, and this is a little teeny thing. And in the handouts you got, it describes the dwarfs and the intermediates and the size range that you can use. These are Mungo junipers. They have a pretty frosty green color, silvery green, actually. Here's a weeping hemlock, and this is kind of just a unique tree. It's got just small, little, flat, soft needles, and it cascades down. It's probably 3-4 feet tall. This is a contorted white pine, and this has silver edges on its long needles, and they're all poorly shaped. And this is, again, a favorite of the deer. They've eaten it off as far as they can reach. This was taken before they got a hold of it. Here's a bowling ball arborvita, and that's, you can buy them, and they're in a round shape, and they're little when you get them, but it's bushel basket size. No, I mean, it grew, but it keeps a round shape, and you don't have to prune it. Just kind of a clever name, bowling ball. Here's Vanderwolf's pine, and this is a long-needled pine, and it has silver edges on the needle. It's just kind of an attractive, different specimen. Here's a cypress pinope, and they have flat branches. I've had trouble with some dieback in the winter on this one, but it prunes nicely, and it almost looks like a bonsai if you prune it, because it has an oriental flat shaped branches. This is a dwarf bristlecone pine. The bristlecone pines are the oldest conifers known, or 5,000 years old, I think some of them are. And this is a dwarf, so it's just a tiny little thing. This is a Wichita blue juniper, and it's a beautiful blue silver green color. And this is just an interesting example. In your handout, it tells you, I think, five different ways that miniature and dwarf evergreens are propagated. And this is called a witch's broom. And I read about it, and there are grown men that go up north and hunt witch's brooms and camp out and grab these things and climb up the trees and then bring these little shoots back and propagate them, trying to get a new specimen. And I saw that one between Briarville and Long Prairie on a pine tree by the side of the road. So that's what that is. That's a witch's broom. It's different from the parent needles on that tree. A lot of willows that you go drive by in the road, the little bush willows have witch's brooms on them. They don't know what causes them. Could be an insect or a virus. This is just an example of some big pine cones, the Coulter pine cone and the sugar pine cone. Coulter is the heaviest, and they only grow up in California, but if they're called widow makers, if that falls on you and you're under the tree, you're a goner. The sugar pine cone is the longest one that can grow at least 2 feet tall. And the pine cones have Fibonacci numerical designs, as many of our plants and animals do. The seashells have those same spherical numbers. And here's just some pine cones, and the little sheaf, single one on the left, probably has two seeds in it, and they germinate at various times. Some need heat, forest fires, before they can germinate, and they're kind of interesting little things. That's a goal of mine yet, is to start some conifers from seeds. This is a Fibonacci number system, the 34 seeds arching in one direction and 55 in the other. A sunflower head has that same design in it, if you look at it. It's quite remarkable. Okay, here's a Mugo pine, and this shows the male and female cones on it. This green one in the center, that large one, is the female cone, and those little brown ones are the male cones. And this is a bloom before the cones. And this is a weeping Norway spruce, and has beautiful red cones periodically, and they stay red for probably 3 months, and then they gradually turn brown, and then for a whole year the brown ones turn downward and hang down. It's just a spectacular sight. This just shows the lion garden. This shows you, remember those three little Colorado blue spruce that I planted 3 feet apart? Well, 10 years later, they're touching each other, which is fine. This just shows another garden, Larry's Whimsy. He had some dragons. Scared the kids, I guess. This is a path between those yellow flowers, and it goes into the Circle Rock garden. And this is the corner edge of the berm garden, and you can see the valley view further on, and that's sprinkled with conifers and a few flowers in it too. The one by the tree, which you can't see really clearly on the picture, is a whipcord arborvitae, and it has long whips that come out of it, just single strands. And I have an example on the bulletin board there if you want a better look at it. Okay, and this is another view of the lion garden, and shows you the different conifers, that weeping large European larch and the bird's nest spruce and the Colorado blue spruce, and then there's a fire and ice hydrangea in the background. And another view of it. And that's that tall one, is that weeping white spruce. And if you want an evergreen and you've got a narrow space, that's only 3 feet wide. It's almost 30 feet tall. It's really remarkable. And this is a profile view of the Circle Rock garden, and it almost looks like a sculpture garden. Now, the topiary ones are kind of a lot of work to maintain. You have to be pruning those pretty regularly to keep that shape. That's just because our monarchs are coming back. I had a lot of them this year, did you? I mean, I think they're successful in bringing them back. And just for fun, other uses for conifers, I make snowmen every year. And 1 year, just for fun, I just prune some branches for hair for it. This is another use for conifers. Every Christmas I make Christmas centerpieces because I do a lot of entertaining. Our master gardeners have a Christmas party at my house. I figure I have to give them a centerpiece. And this is like 5 different kinds of conifer branches and 6 roses from a big box store, really cheap. And then I take skewers and put Christmas balls on them and put them in the arrangement. So you can get by with very few roses and get a really lavish looking bouquet, and then tuck a few baby spread in it. And you can make it in any color you would want, white or gold or anything. But it works really well. And then I just sprayed a middle red pan from the dollar store base of it and put foam in it. And Easter eggs, and I think this is gonna be better than working. Because the trees were just the right height, and little Ellie was about 2 or 3 years old. Well, I know why, because I had them on trees. Okay, there she is. She gathered her eggs, and it was really fun. It was one of the few times that we can have an Easter egg hunt outside. And that's the end of my slideshow. So now you've seen my gardens, and we can turn the lights on and get to the fun part of questions and answers and comments. I'll tell you, first of all, this is when I went out to pick my samples this morning. This was laying on the ground, and this is that silver luck Korean fir, and the deer have been, they're my worst predators for my conifers. I have to tell you, they eat them, and they rub their antlers on it. Now also, I was gonna say, if you're purchasing evergreens, you get what you pay for, as you know. And the Isley Nursery, which is in Oregon, has one of the finest conifer gardens, and they sell only to wholesale. You can't buy direct from them, but if you find something with an Isley label on it, you know it's really good. And on the back, they tell you every single thing you could ever want to know about it. Gene Isley founded the nursery out there and developed many conifers. So if you just pass that around, look at that. Yeah, I'm gonna show you one more thing. This, you belong to the American Conifer Society. You get all that literature and information, and you can go to national meetings and everything, and then also, once a year, they sell conifers to members only, and they're not on the market yet. They're just brand new developed. And we splurged and bought 2 1 year. And I'll just pass this around because this is a cutie. It was in 2014, and this is an icebreaker, Aves coriana. It's like that silver lock, only it's just the cutest thing. It's barely larger than a dinner plate, and it's got beautiful white. Needles on it. Now, it's just a remarkable thing. But like I said, they're not cheap. But I look at it as an investment, and some of my conifers have bit the dust. But I say if I've had it for 15 years, I've gotten a lot of enjoyment out of it. So I don't look at it as a bad thing. Okay, now we can go to questions. Trying to think if there's anything else. Oh, pruning. Pruning is a kind of a complex thing with conifers. Because they don't like pruning, they don't grow back, so don't prune them unless you've got a really good reason to. I have pruned, how to prune conifers here in my book, and there's a different method for 7 different kinds, so I'm not going to go into each one, but first ask why. The author of this article, Bert Craig, says, back in college, my professor used to rant, never prune conifers without a darn good reason. Actually, his language was a little saltier than that. The point is to remember there is no place for recreational pruning of conifers because they don't replace growth like other trees and shrubs. So you have to have a purpose. And sometimes it's to keep the form. Size control, well, it's hard to really control the size. Some hedge type can be pruned regularly and kept under control. Prune for health, remove there's all, if you're interested in pruning a specific one, you can leave your name, I'll send you information, or you can look at this book. Any questions? Yes?
Well, with pines and spruce, full grown, let's say 30 feet high, okay, yeah, when that, I got clients that asked me to cut the branches off, sometime, they bleed so bad. When's the best time to cut them off so they don't bleed?
What kind of tree?
Either Colorado spruce or white pine.
Let's see.
Maybe I'm getting deep in this, but. Because it gets so much sap coming down.
When dormant, in late winter or late summer?
Late winter?
Late winter or late summer.
Both?
When they're dormant.
Both species?
Yeah, but some of them like to be pruned in the spring when they get their new growth, and then they'll grow again. And if you look at a pine branch, look closely, you see all the little nodules that are coming out that are going to be shoots for next year. So you can see those are all going to come out and be branches. And so you can prune anything back when there's still nodules under it that are going to grow. But if you go beyond that, they're just dead ducks. So.
Sharon, what made this last winter so hard on you?
That's a really good question. I think nobody knows. I just don't know. Do you got a guess? I just don't know. It was really hard on my stuff. Conifers.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, they just half dead. So I had to dig quite a few of them out. Just eliminating.
We've got some techni-arborvitae that came through the winter just fine. Neighbors to the east of us had a row of arborvitae they bought at Walmart.
Yeah.
And it didn't turn out fine. They all just burned up.
Okay. Well, see, that's so hard. That's why I passed around this label. And when I was first starting to talk about conifers, I had quite a large class, and I mentioned Isley Nurseries in Oregon. Well, someone said, Oregon isn't the same climate zone as we are, so you can't get plants. That would be good. And I just kind of panicked, and I thought, oh. And I didn't say anything. I just let them tell me I was wrong, and then I went home and looked it up in Oregon. Actually, it's three different climate zones in the state, so this nursery is in its own compatible with ours. But that's important, and the ones from Walmart, who knows where they bought them. That might be why they didn't pull through.
And I don't, if you look at the zone on some of those tags, they're not from Minnesota.
They're not from Minnesota.
Not for us.
I know that. You have to be careful about that. And I have bought quite a few of mine at Menards, and mainly Menards, and Home Depot. And the thing of it is to buy them right away when they're fresh in the store, not after they've been tipped over by wind 20 times and not watered regularly and everything. And then check the labels. Another thing that I've discovered too that I didn't know about when we started, but through the Master Gardeners program, I learned about this root girdling of trees. That a few years ago, they were really stressing that. And I did plant some, and I can see now the circle of roots going around the top. I think it's too late to do anything about it. But that's important when you take them out of the tubs to make sure you rough up the roots. And watering the first 2 years is really critical too for newly planted ones. This fall we've had a lot of water. So, any other questions? How the needle drop is a problem with the large spruce too, and it's the most common disease. And the Colorado blues have got a real bad reputation for having it bad. So rhizal. Plasphora needle cast. It's a fungal disease. Not too much you can do about it. So grow a different variety. The dwarf ones don't seem a subject to it. I haven't had any trouble with the dwarf. Colorado's having a problem. And pine trees have a blight and canker, and fir needs a lot of water. It doesn't do well if it's too dry. So, I don't know. Any other questions?
The white pine, yeah, that's, they have a natural needle drop, though.
All pines have a, that's a good point to bring up. All pines have a needle drop, so don't be concerned. They lose almost half their needles each year. And what I do is I kind of shake them to have the dead ones fall off. Another method you could do is take a hose and spray it. Gets a lot of the dead needles off. But that's what they do. They do drop a lot of needles. And that doesn't mean they've got a disease. The diseased ones, the dead needles hang on. It kind of affects the whole looks of the tree. But if they're, you know, just going through their natural leaf shedding, they will come off.
That canker, is there anything you can do about that when you get pine?
I've never had it, and I don't know. Let's see.
Well, lucky me, I got it.
Mogo and red pine are susceptible to this shoot blight and canker. Let's see. When it is severe, and it often is, tree removal is the best option for management. I mean, I just, conifers, you know, they don't recover. Hedges, you know, you can prune down to the ground, beautiful new growth, but not with conifers.
Well, and someone, a nursery told us too that ours have been stung by wasps.
That what?
That stung by wasps. Wasps actually stung the tree. We took a sample to her, and he said to just cut the tree down.
Yeah.
The tree got stung by wasps?
Yeah.
Oh, I've never heard
of it before.
Okay.
And he goes, as soon as I looked at the idea that trees being stung by wasps, he said there's nothing you can do about it. Just have to
really?
So.
I have no idea. Did you ever hear that, Steve?
No.
No.
That's
I
not
think,
my story.
That sounds like a far fetched story.
What's
he
what's
didn't
the story about?
Colorful seasons.
Really?
Yeah.
Wasps usually don't sting trees.
Yeah, but this guy, the gal went back and got this guy, and he looked down and he said, yeah, that's what it was. And pretty rare.
You bought it.
And we do have a lot of wasps.
Yeah, we have a severe amount of wasps.
Oh, you did have a lot of wasps.
We do.
Yeah. Oh, you do. Okay.
Are they ones that build a nest up in the tree then?
Well,
in everywhere.
Everywhere. I mean, in my trailer, it doesn't matter. Anything I do when they're building a nest.
Okay.
Are they stung or were they totally in there?
I've had little inchworms, I don't know their names, like spruce needle worms on the spruces. And they devour the needles, but they're kind of cute little things that wiggle back and forth, and they never do more than a section, small section. So I just leave them. I figure the birds will eat them. They're not enough to spray or do anything with. And all the conifers have a waxy coating on it called the bloom, I think they call it, that helps them live through the winter because they have this protection.
Have you ever tried using something like the wilt-proof for some of these transfers in order to seal the needles?
No, I have not, but I understand it is available, and I have friends who have Christmas tree farms, and they use that a lot on their tree farms. But I've not used it. I've thought of it, you know? I don't know. It just add an extra layer of protection. Oh, do you know anything about that, anyone else? It's not readily available, and I don't see it on shelves where I can just go pick it up. So, but I know you can get it.
We used to use it, especially on evergreens that we planted for landscaping. In the first season, we'd go out and spray them, and it seemed really helpful.
Okay. Do you remember where you got the spray?
Well, you can get it through like a horticulture supply place.
Okay, like a nursery might have it.
Or they could get it for you.
Yeah, they would order it for you. Okay, yes.
I have seen it at Bachman's in the city.
Okay, at Bachman's, sure.
In
yeah,
Paris.
Their nursery, yep, okay. Yeah, it'd probably be worth trying. Because evergreens are costlier than many deciduous plants. I mean, they just are.
Mm-hmm.
Hot seed.
I just remember one critical thing that I learned way, way back when, is for any type of conifer or pine or whatever, if you get into a drought situation, you know, in July and August, you have a dry summer, make sure your conifers are watered around August and September so they go into winter in a, you know, with good moisture. That was, I learned that way back when.
That's absolutely true.
Yeah, don't let them go in the winter dry.
No, don't let them go in the winter dry, and particularly the first 2-3 years that they're planted, because they won't survive, you know, a harsh winter if they're dry.
And that's especially true on foundation planting of, you know, if you have evergreen.
Yes, because you've got such a limited soil on the way to the house, it could be really dry, you know. And as far as another question that is common is, what conifers grow well in the shade? And my experience is that the yews do well in the shade. They actually prefer it. And I haven't had any good luck with anything else.
What kind?
Y-E-W. They like it. Mm-hmm.
But I've also noticed, with especially spruce, if you got irrigation, it wipes out the tree too when it hits the bottom.
Too much water. Yeah.
And then it just, you can see the brown just goes straight up.
And I've watched over the years, I drive to Alexandria to shop because I live in Eagle Bend. And that somebody planted a whole, I suppose, close to an acre of conifers, and they started out little ones, and it's a kind of a hilly place with a dip. Well, over the years, the ones in the low area all died out because it was too wet for them. I mean, you could just see that that was the issue with them. So they have to have enough water, but not too much. So kind of fussy that way too. But I find a bonus with these little conifers, which I have a lot in my yard, little birds love to nest in them. And every one has at least one or two nests in them all summer long.
I think sporadic acid in water and then put it down by the roots. What's the best time to do that, spring or fall?
I think spring is always good when there's new growth, and then don't do it after August. Yeah. I have bought, Larry and I disagreed about fertilizing the evergreens because we got basically miniature and unusual conifers, and I want them to grow real fast, and he thinks they all have to be fertilized. I said, no, you know, they don't need fertilizer. So we went round and round about that. But some of them, if they look kind of sickly and aren't doing well, I've used these fertilizer spikes in the ground around them too. So.
Did you ever read about them?
Read about them?
Are
they bad?
Yeah.
What do they do?
They're full of different material, and they allow the roots to grow unevenly in a tree because they only will, you know, cover that much.
Okay.
And some of them have an acid in them.
Nasty things.
Yeah, I had a neighbor who recommended, oh, you got to do these. So I did.
Okay.
And a couple of trees that I did them to died.
Oh, okay.
And the rest of them that I just used near acid on have done well.
Yeah.
Yeah, read about the...
Well, they like a little acidity, most of them, conifers. Larry insisted on these fertilizers. He put them in around some of the trees, but I didn't notice any difference.
After I read it, I had some, so I just busted them up into powder.
Oh, okay.
And then
spread
them around.
Yeah, I still have some in a cabinet because I don't believe in it. Any other questions?
I don't have a question. I've got a picture.
All right.
I think it's probably the winter.
Sure. Looks like winter burn. A lot of it down by the bottom. Dog urine.
That's what my wife's.
Well. Beautiful. Sure. It looks, a daughter could have used it more than once. That's deadly. My brother had a male dog that he brought over that. I cringed every time he came to visit. I always said, bring it in the house. Bring your dog in the house because it would do that. brown ones up here, you could just prune them out a little bit, you know, and prune it a little bit and cut them, so it isn't so bad. Any other questions?
When the evergreens are bigger Colorado, and I'm not sure what the other ones are, and they start losing their needles on the inside.
Yes.
Is there anything you can do about that?
No, there isn't.
If they get bigger, they just?
They just do that, they get old, just like people get old, you know, lose our hair, lose our needles in a way, so I don't think so, not to my knowledge. They don't, you know, that doesn't get sunlight in there, and the circulation isn't as good. So I have some old ones now too that are showing some age, and I'm just gonna, when they get too unsightly, they're gonna just go. Steve?
I know they're recommending now not even to plant Colorado blue spruce in the state of Minnesota, you know? Have the needle cast and cankers and all those problems, they're not even recommending planting anymore.
Right, that's been a number of years now.
Yeah.
They've been in doghouse, but they're such a beautiful tree.
Oh, gosh, yes.
I don't like it.
Really?
But maybe they've developed new varieties, I understand they got new ash trees now that are resistant to ash or, so maybe they'll come up with something.
Was that the Colorado, did you say?
The Colorado blue spruce.
What about, I think we have Black Hills.
Black Hills are fine, they don't have any problems right now that I know of, yeah.
The what?
Except the Black Hills spruce?
No, I've got two of those, and they're, that was Larry's favorite tree, they're just a beautiful short needle, dark green, hunter green, yeah, they're nice. So they're, they'd be preferable than to plant over the Colorado blue.
The other one that's recommended is Myers spruce.
Yes.
It won't give you a bluish color, but it's
Right.
definitely hardier for our area.
Yes, yes, I saw a grove of those also. Plants beautiful near Parker's Ferry, if you've been to their place, he has a lot of